Praise the Lord, everybody. We're glad you're able to join us tonight for our midweek Bible study here at Life Church. And we have got a word from the Lord for all of you. And we are also going to make a few brief announcements tonight. And we hope that you'll share this with your friends. We hope that you will invite folks to watch tonight. We've got a good Bible study. I don't like to come to the pulpit without fresh bread. And I believe that the Lord will bless you if you will listen with a sincere heart and with the ears of the Spirit rather than just your human nature. One of the most important things that we do as Christians is we see spiritually and we hear spiritually. And we're grateful for all those who are joining us tonight via Facebook Live. The first thing that I want to just make some clarification on is we have opened our church back up for Sunday service, and we're grateful to be able to do that. It's been a little bit slow for people to catch on and to join us in service. We had a good service this past Sunday, and grateful for everyone that was here. But June is right around the corner, and we would like for our attendance to begin to build back up. And but we will be making a decision somewhere in the month of June about our midweek Bible study, whether we want to continue to do this on Facebook Live or if we're going to open our church back up for those who would like to actually come in the sanctuary and participate in Bible study. Now, prior to COVID, our midweek service was a little low in attendance, so I would like some assurances from folks that you will attend before we go ahead and begin that with a live service. Facebook Live is fine, but it's never a substitute for meeting together with the body of Christ and encouraging one another in fellowship and in faith. And we appreciate you joining us. We appreciate your comments on Facebook. There have been many that have joined and encouraged folks to participate in our church that don't even go here. We appreciate that very much. We want to encourage you to stay tuned in to the Spirit of the Lord. I want to thank Brother Dan Jackson tonight for helping us to get us with good sound. And hopefully you can hear us tonight as we teach the Word of the Lord. Also, we want to continue to pray for our community and pray for those who are still in hospitals, those who are still fighting this disease worldwide. It's not just about Elwood. It is also about the state of Indiana. It's also about some of our more heavily populated counties such as Cass County, Marion County, Elkhart. Some of these areas are very heavily hit. We want to pray for them. We want to pray for the United States of America. We want to pray for the world. Some of our missionaries have told me that they have been hit very, very heavily by COVID. One of those countries is the nation of India. It's been very heavily hit. You've heard next to nothing on the news about India's suffering during COVID. But we want to pray because we know a God who can heal on a worldwide basis. And God is faithful to us who put him first. So right now, we're going to ask you all to join us in prayer as we pray for two things. We're going to pray for those who are fighting COVID, for those who are grieving the loss of their loved ones who have come under COVID. And we also want to pray tonight that our ears and our hearts would be open to the word of the Lord. Amen. Does no good to hear, just listen to the word of the Lord. We must apply it to our life, and that's very important. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we come to your throne of grace in our time of need, and we ask you, Lord, for healing virtue to go throughout the state of Indiana. Lord, to those that are fighting in hospitals, to those who are serving our communities through medical care. We pray, God, that healing would come and that the curve would be flattened. God, we pray for the United States of America. We pray, God, that you would help us to think right, to pray right, to study your word right. And God, we pray that our churches would be allowed to be open once again to fulfill the command of Christ and to do the work of the kingdom. God, in some states we know that governors are afraid to allow churches to have congregations come together. We pray that you would open those doors for those churches and allow them to assemble and to worship you, Lord. God, we pray that you would touch the nations of the world that are fighting this virus. We pray specifically for India. God, we pray for South America. We pray for Africa. And God, we pray for those countries that have limited resources, that you would heal and deliver those that are calling on you for miracles, signs, and wonders. And God, we pray tonight that you would fill our hearts and our minds full of the Holy Ghost. And Lord, that we would be led and listen with the ears of the Spirit, and that our eyes would be opened by your Spirit. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray, and we ask it all for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Now, we've been talking for the last several weeks about the book of Joshua, and we've been talking about how to possess promises. Amen. I don't know about you, but I want to possess some promises, not just talk about them. And I want to have what God says I can have. Now, I've been studying the chapters of Joshua, chapter 5 and chapter 6. And for the sake of time, I'm not going to read you all of the details that are in chapters 5 and 6, but oh, isn't there a wealth in these two chapters about how the children of Israel were now going to come into their promised land, and boy, there's some great things in chapter 5 and chapter 6. Now, there are six things that we see take place in these two chapters that I'm going to talk about that are relevant to you and I receiving our promises in today's times. Amen. Now, the first thing that we see in chapter 5 was the enemies of Israel saw God do miracles for Israel. And the Bible says that the hearts of their enemies melted in fear. Amen. And then the second thing that happened was God brought his people through the Jordan River on dry ground. He brought them through the water on dry ground. And what a miracle that was. Now, the third thing that we see is Joshua is commanded by the Lord to circumcise the men of Israel. And this is important for us to understand how it applies in the New Testament church and how that we are blessed because of this analogy. Then the Bible says that Joshua meets an angelic captain. The Bible calls him the captain of the Lord of hosts. Joshua sees him and does not recognize him, but he introduces himself and he says that I am the captain of the Lord of hosts. My, I wonder what it would be like if the captain of the Lord of hosts would all of a sudden appear in your living room and help you to fight the battles. My, how wonderful that would be. Then the Bible teaches us that the children of Israel, they kept the Passover. They ate the Passover supper, and there is much in that we glean from this situation about the Passover. And then finally, the Bible teaches us that the children of Israel, as long as they were in the wilderness on the other side of Jordan, that they were fed every day except the Sabbath day with manna. Manna had continually fed them for 40 years. God fed his children with manna from heaven. But once they crossed over the Jordan and they got into their promised land, the manna ceased. And we're going to talk about that in just a few moments. Amen. That was found in Joshua chapter 5 and verse 12. Now, let's talk about how do all of these events relate to obtaining God's promises in the year 2020. Now, when God's people were going to go over the Jordan, and God divided the Jordan River, and then they were in the territory that God had promised them, they immediately realized that the Ammonites were there, and they were idol-worshiping people, and they had kings and armies. And the Canaanites were there, and they had kings, and they had armies, and they worshipped idols, and they were vicious warriors. They were feared warriors, but we have to realize that God was on their side the minute that they crossed over the waters of Jordan on dry ground. We have an enemy, and we need to know who our enemy is, because our enemy, according to the scripture, is called Satan. A lot of people think that he is just a horned little demon in a red suit with a pointy tail. But listen, Satan is the enemy of your promises. Satan does not want you to see the power of God at work in your life. And Satan, he will do anything to stop you from getting what God said you can have. He does not want anyone to receive anything from God. If there's one enemy that will try to stop you from getting your healing, getting discernment, getting financial blessing, getting all of the things that God says you can have, it's Satan himself and the demons in which he controls. Everything from God and God's power working in your life, Satan wants to stop you from having that. Now, you have to understand that Satan is the enemy of your promise. Amen. The Bible says, Jesus said, I will never leave you or forsake you. But how many of you have stayed up all night long feeling lonely and depressed and anxious, and you could not get past your loneliness? You know what happens? Satan comes in and he attacks your ability to believe God for the promises. And sometimes Satan does not appear in some type of a form or a thought, but he actually works through people to discourage you and to cause you to not get your promise. That's why we need to pray for folks who have unsaved spouses, because they live in an environment where they have no one else. Their spouse does not encourage them in faith and in love and in the Word of God. And guess who gets in the mind of that unsaved, unspirit-led, unspirit-filled spouse and picks on the spirit-filled person? It's the devil and his demons. Amen. We've got to understand that people who are not spirit-filled and are not spirit-led, many of them are manipulated and used by demons to defeat you from receiving from God. Now, we don't have a right to hate anybody. We don't have a right to be belligerent to anybody. But you do need to recognize your enemy and his tactics. And so God's people had crossed over into the promised land, but they had help, spiritual help, to get to their promise, and we're going to talk about that. Now, these kings, the king of the Ammonites and the kings of Canaan and Jericho, the Bible says that when they saw the God of Israel part the waters of Jordan and cross over on dry ground, the Bible says that because they saw that miracle,
in the life of the Israelites that their hearts melted with fear and they had no spirit in them. One of the things that your enemy has got to see, the greatest miracle that your enemy has got to see in your life, is the miracle of salvation. And I'm talking about true salvation. Amen. When the devil sees that you have been radically saved, when your life has been transformed by the infilling of the Holy Ghost, there's no doubt in his mind that you are saved and set apart. He quakes in his shoes because he knows that he's got a fight on his hands. People don't know how to react when a person gets saved. Matter of fact, many times, family members who don't understand will fuss and try to convince you that you've just gotten a little radical and it won't take long till you'll go back to your old ways. But you want to show them that God did a miracle in your life and he saved you and that you are forever radically transformed. People that you work with will go, "What's happened to him?" And the devil will say, "You know what, I better get some more demonic help, because now they're saved and they're full of the Holy Spirit and they are going to be a hard person to fight against." Your enemy needs to know that you have had the miracle of salvation to come into your life. You shouldn't be saved, but God saved you anyway by his grace and his mercy. You're happy about it. You're no longer singing the same song that you used to sing, "Oh, I'm getting happy tonight," because salvation is a miracle. If you want to show the enemy what you are now, when Jesus brings you through your Jordan River, when you come through from Egypt into your promised land, which is typifying salvation, there's going to be some victory in you. Amen. Now, true salvation, let me just say this. True salvation is not merely joining a church. There are a lot of people who come to church, but they have not gotten saved. And, you know, I can stand in a garage, but that does not make me a car. Amen. I can stand in the White House, but it doesn't make me the president. You can come to church and do churchy things, but the devil will know and the saints will know when you have been radically transformed by the power of the Word of God and the Holy Ghost. If you want to set the devil on edge, get radically saved. Hallelujah. Don't go somewhere where they let you get by with sin and still call yourself a Christian. No, get full of the Holy Ghost. Get full of the Word. Get full of preaching. Come and learn how powerful your life can be. Amen. True salvation is not just coming to church dinners or getting baptized or reading a creed. Amen. True salvation is a conversion of the heart and the mind. It is radical. It is transforming of a person's life. Amen. When a person truly gets saved, you can't keep them out of church. When a person truly gets saved, you can't keep them from testifying about the goodness of the Lord and every demon in hell.
You're hot.
Praise the Lord. Sorry about technical difficulties. I was finishing up on that first point, and that is, if you want God's promises, then get radically saved. Amen. Now, the second thing that we see is Joshua circumcised all the men of Israel. And this is one of those subjects that people get a little squeamish about. But there is a significance to it in the New Testament church. And this was a command of the Lord. The Lord told Joshua to make sharp knives and go through the act of being set apart by circumcision. The men that were in the wilderness that had originally been circumcised
amen, the Bible says that they died in their unbelief. And so their children that God raised up, for whatever reason, in the 40 years of wandering, they had considered this rite of circumcision unnecessary. But this was a command of the Lord that had been forgotten, and it was considered unnecessary while in the wilderness, even though the Lord commanded it. Now, there are some mandatory things that had become merely ceremonial. There was an attitude within Israel that says, well, we're okay without it. And it had developed, listen, in the wilderness. Now, Joshua chapter 5 and verse 9 says, and the Lord said unto Joshua, this day have I rolled away the reproach of Egypt from you, wherewith the name of this place is called Gilgal unto this day. And Gilgal means a rolling away. So when all of the men of Israel were now again in right order with the Lord, this thing that had become unnecessary and merely ceremonial that they had dropped during the wilderness, you see, they weren't in their promised land yet, but as soon as they crossed over, the Bible, the Lord commanded that they go back and do some things that were still important to God. How does this pertain to receiving the promises of God? Understand this, child of God. What's important to God should be important to you. And I don't care who tells you that this isn't necessary and that isn't necessary, and you don't need to go to church, you don't have to go to church to be saved, and even though the Bible says, do not forsake the assembling of yourselves together as the manner of some is, and there have been a lot of things in the Scripture that have been deemed by people to be unimportant, when actually, if it's important to God, it's important to us. Amen. Some have belittled the sacraments of the church, such as Holy Communion. I heard a pastor say just not long ago, I can't remember the last time we received communion in our church. It had been over 3 years, and this is a Spirit-filled church. It had been over 3 years since they had participated in Holy Communion. And some have put file cabinets and stacked up, made the baptismal pool a place of storage because they no longer baptize people in their baptismal tank. But I'm telling you that if it's important to God, it should be important to us. Some people have laid aside personal holiness, and they say, well, you know, that's just young people. Young people are going to sow their wild oats, and they're going to do what young people do. Listen to this preacher today. Personal holiness and being separate from the world is important to God. And when God told Joshua, he said, you circumcise all of the males in the camp of Israel, is because it meant something to God. Well, why do we have to do that? It's painful, and it has to be healed up from. And we got through the wilderness just fine without it. Listen, there are some things in this book that are important to God, and we better stop weakening down the gospel just to please certain people who don't like what the Bible has to say. They pick and pick what they like, but they won't do what the Scripture says. It's very important that you examine your personal life and see what's important to God. Get your Bible out and say, God, show me what I need to do. If there are things on my television or on my computer that need to be turned off, if there are things in my family that we don't need to participate in, then get them out of your life. Because the Bible says that when Joshua was commanded of the Lord, this act of circumcision was something that set his people apart from all of the other people. You see, there are going to be some things when you serve the Lord. If you want your promises, you've got to do some things that set you apart from the world. The Bible says, come out from among them. That typifies Egypt or the world. Come out from among them and be ye separate. There are some people that sit on the pew and hate the pastor. There are some people that sit in the pew and won't shake the hand of somebody else. Don't ever think you're going to get the promises of God if you're spreading gossip throughout your town about your pastor or your church. Get your life cleansed at an altar and repent of your sins. Cut the sin off out of your life, and then you will be in a position to be blessed. Examine your personal life. It's important. Amen. God commanded them to go back and do the things they had forsaken in the wilderness. Now, listen to what I'm going to say here. Colossians chapter 2, verse 11 and 12 talks a little bit about this. This is New Testament. This is Paul instructing the Gentile church. Many of the Gentiles in the New Testament church did not grow up in Judaism. They had no law. They did what they wanted. And so they brought some of these things into the church. And the Bible says in Colossians 2, verse 11 and 12, in him, meaning Jesus, also you were circumcised with a circumcision made without hands, by putting off the body of the flesh by circumcision in Christ. When you decided to give your life to Christ, you cut the world off, and you were circumcised into Christ, having been buried with him in baptism. You know what? There are people who think that baptism, it going down in the water, somehow makes them perfect with God. Listen, all you did was get wet. But if you have gotten baptized for the correct purpose, then you have told the world, I am separated unto God, and I want the church to know and the world to know that I have separated my life unto God, being buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through faith in the powerful working of God who raised him from the dead. Paul told the Gentile church at Colossae to stop living immoral lives. In chapter 3, verse 5, he said very plainly, put to death, therefore, what is earthly in you, sexual immorality, impurity, passions, evil desires, and covetousness, which is idolatry. In other words, a putting off or a cutting away of fleshly sin has to be done if you want to possess the promises of God. If they would have disobeyed God and said, we've been good through the whole wilderness, we're not going to go through this surgical procedure as grown men of circumcision, they would have been defeated and would have never went into their promised land. Jesus was God in the flesh. He was totally sinless. He was alive, but at 8 days old, the Bible says they took him to the temple, and he was circumcised, and he was named in the temple. He could not have fulfilled his purpose on the earth without his name and without circumcision. Both his name and circumcision set him apart. Listen to me. If the Bible says you need to do it, then you need to set yourself apart from the world and gain, amen, what God says you can have. Jesus commanded baptism, as well as Peter and all the apostles, including Paul. If it was important to them, it should be important to us. Now, what happens at baptism? I know some of you don't like me preaching on baptism because you don't feel that it's relevant to the New Testament church. Amen. But in Acts chapter 2, it was important. In Acts chapter 10, it was important for the Gentiles. Amen. Now, let me clarify something here. I do not wash sins away from anybody. I am simply the preacher that baptizes people in obedience to the word of God. You can go down a sinner and come up a wet sinner if you're doing it for the wrong reasons. But if you have placed your faith in Jesus Christ and you have repented of your sins, then baptism shows your obedience, amen, to the command of Jesus and the apostles. Paul tells of his conversion. And he talks about where Ananias said to him. Ananias came in to Paul and he said, "And now, why do you wait? Rise and be baptized and wash away your sins, calling upon his name." Whose name? Jesus Christ. Amen. The Lord commanded that we are to do some things. And I believe it's because of the confession of your faith. Amen. When a person repents of their sins and they confess their faith in Jesus Christ, amen, life enters into them. But because of that new life, amen, then they are obedient to the command of Scripture, just like the Israelites were obedient to circumcision. And so, if you want to receive the promises of God, there are some things that you need to do. Amen. If you go to a church that does not baptize, if you go to a church that does not teach that you can be filled with the Holy Ghost, if you don't go to a church that does not preach personal holiness, if you go to a church that just simply shakes your hand, gives you a card, and takes your money, you need to find a church that agrees with what the Bible says, because otherwise you'll never get your promises. Now, moving on, the Scripture says that until this time, God's people had been fed manna. They had been fed directly from God, manna. And it was given directly to them by the hand of God. It sustained them. It nourished them in the wilderness. But now they were entering into their promised land. And they would receive vineyards that they didn't plant and homes that they did not build. And now they would eat for pleasure and have variety. One thing you hear about the promised land is it flowed with milk and honey. In other words, the land was rich for crops, and there was plenty of fish in the water. There was plenty for animals for them to hunt. And they would have a variety of food. And so now they were entering their promised land, and a new food would feed them for a new place. Amen. When God brings you to new levels, remember the Scripture says you go from faith to faith, and you go from glory to glory. When God brings you into new levels of promise, then you're going to be blessed with new sources of blessing. Amen. When God takes you out of that minimum wage job and he blesses you with a $20 an hour job, then your giving will increase and your blessings will increase and you'll be able to bless others more than you could before. But God will begin to bless your life with greater things and greater experiences. You may be able to move into a different social climate. Why? Because God has brought you into a better land. It's not that the manna was bad. It kept them. But when you get into your promised territory, it'll blow your mind how God's going to bless you. You'll find things in God's Word that you never saw before. You'll find that the promises of God are yes and amen to them that believe. You won't even have doubt come into your mind anymore. You just automatically believe God's going to do it because you moved on. Amen. All your need is supplied, how? According to his riches. Where? In glory. You know what? We look so many times for all of our blessings to be right down here. Thank God for the stimulus check. But you know what? If they had never sent a stimulus check, I was still going to be okay. And child of God, you were going to be okay. Because God takes care of his children. Amen. Now, the Bible goes on to say, the next thing they did was they ate the Passover. They participated in the Passover just like they did on the night before the death angel came through and killed the firstborn in Egypt, but God's children, their firstborn, were protected. Why? Because the blood of a spotless lamb was painted on their doorpost, and they would eat the Passover meal. Coming out of Egypt and crossing over the waters of Jordan, the people recognized that the bitterness of Egypt was now over. Hallelujah. The blood of the Lamb had saved their life. And while they were in Egypt, and now they had passed over into their promise. Listen to what I want to tell you tonight. This is important. I don't care how saved you get. You better remember the day when you were dying in your sins, you were lost without hope, and you didn't have anybody to care about you. Never forget that the blood of Jesus Christ was shed for you. Never forget that you should be dead and in your grave, but the blood of Jesus Christ rescued you. Amen. Every once in a while, you need to have a personal Passover, and you need to realize that you used to be lost, but now you're saved. Every once in a while, you need to pull the curtains of your memory back and realize what it was to be addicted to crack and be addicted to alcohol. But now you're set free, and nobody's chasing you, and nobody's hunting you down. Why? Because God saved you. And the beauty of the Passover is found in the New Testament church. In Holy Communion, it is a constant reminder of the blood of Christ saving us and the Lamb of God laying down his life so that we could be free from death. I can't wait until we're all gathered in this sanctuary so that we can come together and receive Holy Communion and thank him for the blood that he shed. Thank him for the blood that's healed us and kept us from COVID. Thank him for his broken body on Calvary that saved our souls from a devil's hell. You've got to have a respect and a fear of God that thanks him because you're not lost and now you're found. Hallelujah. The Lord's Supper reminds us in John chapter 6 and verse 53, except you eat of the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. The beauty of coming to church and participating in Holy Communion is you don't have any life in you if it wasn't for the blood of Jesus, if it wasn't for his broken body on Calvary. You wouldn't have any forgiveness. You wouldn't have any healing if it wasn't for the stripes laid on his back. You need to participate in the Lord's Supper. And somebody said, well, I don't know if I'm worthy. There's not one person that's living on the earth that is worthy of what God has done for you. The only thing that makes you worthy is the blood of Jesus that was spilled on Calvary. That's what makes you worthy. Amen. The Bible says in John 6:53, except you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. The word life in the Greek is zoe, which means sustaining life. You could not have the Holy Spirit, the life of God living in you, if it wasn't for the death of Jesus Christ on Calvary. Hallelujah. Luke chapter 22, verse 19 and 20. Jesus took bread and gave thanks and broke the bread, and he gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Amen. This is my body, which is given for you. And then he says, this do in remembrance of me. This do in remembrance of me. Amen. This do in the Greek is active tense. And it's active voice, which means continue to do it repeatedly. Amen. You don't have to fear taking communion in an unworthy manner. You're not going there to have a sit-down meal like Cracker Barrel. Amen. You're participating and you're remembering and calling to your your remembrance, you're receiving the spiritual equivalent to his broken body and the blood that poured from his veins. And there are blessings that come from receiving Holy Communion with your brothers and sisters. Amen. The Bible teaches us that we bring blessing upon ourselves when we observe the Lord's Supper. If you want to have the promises of God, you need to actively be attending a church that practices the Lord's Supper. Revelation chapter 12, verse 10 through 11 says, "Now salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ have come. For the accuser of our brethren, who accused them before our God day and night, has been cast down. And they overcame him," listen here, "and they overcame him by two things: the blood of the Lamb," hallelujah, "and by the word of their testimony." Paul called the communion cup of blessing. Amen. I love when the saints of God get together and we receive communion, because I believe there's blessing in receiving that. Don't you know those people that had crossed over the Jordan River and they were eating the Passover supper? They were saying, "We're in our promised land now, and the bitterness of these herbs was a long time ago in Egypt, but now I'm in my promised land, and now I'm going to live in houses that I didn't build. Now I'm going to be blessed in the land that flows with milk and honey." We have a lot to rejoice over, because Jesus Christ, his blood and his broken body, has got for us salvation, and it's for our healing, and it's for the peace of our mind, and it's for the fact that we can go to heaven. Hallelujah. We are blessed by keeping our life set apart for God and living in his holiness and receiving the cup of blessing. Can you receive a Holy Communion unworthy? Yes, if you're actively participating in sin and just frivolously taking the Lord's Supper. Yes, that is unworthy. But listen, there is a remedy for sin, and that remedy is called repentance. If we confess our sins to the Lord, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. If you want the blessings of God abundant in your life, if you want to move into your promised land, then listen, you need the blood of Jesus applied to your life. You need God actively saving you 24/7. I'm so glad that I have given my life to God. I'm so glad that I have turned my life over to him, and my life is blessed because of it. Someone asked the question, "How did you get so blessed? How have you survived 53 years of diabetes and you're not having amputations and you're not having serious side effects?" Listen, I give all the credit to the blood of Jesus. I give all the credit to the promises that are in this book. I live my life to obtain these promises, promises of healing, promises of provision, promises that he never leave me or forsake me. I want the promises of God, and I believe that we can all have them if we will do what God asks of us to do. Now listen, I'm going to close tonight. I know that there are some folks who don't like the old-fashioned ways. They don't like the old way of repenting of your sins, but listen, there are some things that still work. And if you are willing to repent of your sins and give your life to God 100%, God will bless you and he will save you. And we're going to pray right now and ask the Lord that whoever's listening to this, they would sell out to God, give him your life completely. Let's pray together. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I'm asking you, Lord, to turn the light on hearts right now. Lord, I'm asking you to convict the heart of the person who's just playing church and cause them to get in the church. Lord, I pray for every backslider that has walked away from the Father and walked away from his protection. I pray, God, that their heart would yearn to be back in the Father's house. I pray, God, for those who've never heard the gospel, but they want to change in their life. I pray, God, that something we have said, God, that they would repent of their sins and say, Lord, come and save me. I'll do whatever you ask. God, I need for your help to come into my life. God, I pray that right now, wherever they are, God, that they would repent of their sins, find a good church that teaches the truth, and sell out completely to God. Oh God, if we have failed you in any way,
yes.
God, if we have overlooked things that are important to you, then I pray you would convict our heart and that we would go back and examine our life and do what you have asked us to do. And God, we thank you and praise you that you're going to bless everything that was done tonight. You're going to bless every person that's listening with a sincere heart. And we pray right now that lives would be changed, hearts would be saved in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. God bless you tonight. Thank you for joining us. Amen.